Good evening, everyone. Good evening and welcome. We're delighted to have you with us. I think we have an exciting Science Board program in store tomorrow. The Science Board will then be meeting on Saturday, our Board of Trustees on Sunday, and we're really pleased to have such a good group, and I hope you'll find all the talks tomorrow both enjoying and enriching. With that, though, it's obviously with great sadness that we saw last week the passing of our co-founder, our great friend and great supporter, George Cowan, and we're dedicating this Science Board meeting to his memory. We'll have several of our Science Board members talking about George tomorrow morning. We'll have some opportunities as well at the board meeting on Sunday. There'll be a memorial service for George later this month, and the Institute is going to be working to have a celebration of George and science in the fall, and if we can time it, perhaps right before the Business Network and trustee meeting in November. But our thoughts are with him. I was fortunate enough to have lunch sitting next to George just two weeks ago, and although frail, he was still quite sharp, and his sense of humor unabated, I think, right up to the end. So he's certainly in our thoughts, and I say we'll have more to say about George tomorrow morning. It's my pleasure this evening to welcome a longtime SFI faculty member, both external faculty and Science Board member, Tim Kohler. Tim is in the best profession in the world. He's an archaeologist, which is it may not be the oldest, but it's the best. He's a Regents Professor at Washington State University. He's spent most of his professional career teaching at Washington State. He's in the field of archaeology been, I think, a major innovator and pioneer in studying adaptive social systems, but particularly been concerned, and this is kind of a strong SFI trait, in agent-based modeling of social and cultural systems. He's interested in causality in complex systems, in computational social science more generally. Has done field work throughout the Southwest, most recently at Mesa Verde in Colorado, but he also did major work and published a major monograph on work here at Bandelier National Park as well. Concerned particularly with understanding how towns and villages arose in the Southwest. He's directing a particular project on village ecodynamics, and again, looking particularly using computational and simulation modeling methods to understand how early agricultural villages not only arose but then developed through time in the Southwest in particular, and then more generally as well. He's written a host of books and papers. The most recent one, hot off the press, Emergence and Collapse of Early Villages, Models of Central Mesa Verde Archaeology. He's a senior editor, published just this month by the University of California Press. He also has edited, again, senior editor of Leaving Mesa Verde, Peril and Change in the 13th Century Settlement of the Southwest. He's edited a book with Sandra Vanderloo, another one of our external faculty, on model-based archaeology of socio-natural systems. Another book with another external faculty member, George Gummerman, on dynamics in human and primate society, agent-based modeling of social and spatial phases. So he's really been at the forefront of applying a variety of modeling and simulation to archaeology with a number of important results. We're delighted to have Tim with us. He just spent a small part of a sabbatical term at SFI, too short. He was with us for a good part of two months, and we hope to have him back as well. He's going to talk to us tonight on 10 lessons from 20 years building a complexity-informed archaeology. Please join me in welcoming Tim Kohler.
Thank you, Jared.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me all right? You know, Jerry might not have been quite so kind in his introduction if he had seen some of our first attempts to build agent-based models in Swarm. I'll tell you about those, but I won't show you some of the lessons from those. One of the lessons, in fact, from one of our very first models was we had our landscape very nicely constructed, and you'll see some examples of these, and we were really excited to finally get the agents put out on the landscape, and lo and behold, they all marched towards one side and fell off the end. So that's a lesson, but that's not the lessons I'm going to be talking to you about so much tonight. I think that we need to consider ourselves to all be Neolithicers. Our bodies constitute evolutionary hypotheses about how to succeed on a diet of domesticated plants and animals. Every year about this time, our gardens call us to enact ancient rituals of planting that probably make little economic sense for most of us, yet are in some way deeply satisfying. Our minds are finally attuned to the intricacies and scales of physical and social accounting in the Neolithic. By the close of the Neolithic, in most areas, social evolutionary processes dictated that the largest social unit our ancestors regularly engaged with was already much larger than those they had known in the Pleistocene, but that was not true at the beginning. We find it inexplicably pleasant, for example, to contemplate small villages in the Cotswolds or in Bourgogne, even if these are obviously sanitized and idealized as in this image. But we also know that there was a dark side to this small-scale social organization. We have an intuitive understanding of what's going on in this scene of plundering and burning of a small village, and we can imagine both what is shown and also what is not shown. So as Jerry implied, for most of my career, I've been working on the problem of things like why villages form and where they form out of smaller scale entities that would be, you know, just individual households or very small sites like hamlets. We're wanting to know what the frequency and role of warfare in such societies is. And we want to understand these pressures and processes that cause the small-scale political organizations of village-level societies to evolve into larger-scale organizations over the course of anywhere from a few hundred years to a couple thousand years, depending on the sequence. As Jerry said, though, unlike many of my colleagues, I've emphasized models and methods that I've learned about, at least partially through my affiliation with SFI, over a period of 20 years. So my goal tonight is really twofold. I want to share some of the substantive insights from this work, but I also want to render homage to the methods permitting these insights, and perhaps if I have a little time, suggest a few future directions in which SFI could play an important role in such efforts. The Neolithic was late in coming to the Americas and also especially to the Southwest. What I've done here is take a map that is available right online. You could do the same thing, select a particular area, have the map on the fly show me all the sites, all the Neolithic sites with maize in them from Mesoamerica and North America, and you can select different kinds of sites if you want. And then it makes a little map showing the dates for the earliest such sites within specific regions. And you can probably see, though it's a little small, the earliest maize is down here. It was domesticated out of a teosinte, an annual teosinte, about 9,000 years ago. We know that from molecular evidence, but very shortly thereafter, by about 8500 BC or so, we begin to pick it up in the archaeological record down there. But as you can see, it kind of stalled out down there for some time, and it wasn't until about 4500 BC years ago that it started to move very rapidly up here to the north, arriving in the southwest here about 4,000 years ago. That would be 2000 BC. And then once again, it kind of stalled out for a good long time before it got over into eastern United States at a relatively late date, where it caused the blossoming of socio-political organizations in the southeast at huge sites like Cahokia, for example. So the area I'm going to be talking about, and here is the southwest, we're down over here someplace, is up here, the Village Ecodynamics Project study area. It was even later in getting the Neolithic. It wasn't until about 600 AD that farmers began to colonize this area. The big lag is most likely, is not really completely understood, but it's most likely due to the fact that we had quite a warm period from about AD 600 to about AD 1200 overall, with some spatial anomalies, sometimes called the medieval warm period. This area is relatively high in elevation, and it may be the case that those warmer conditions allowed farmers to be able to bring maize to maturity in this area, and that might not have been possible earlier than that. So the important thing, one important thing to remember about the people I'm going to be telling you, is that they were maize farmers, and they got an extraordinary proportion of their diet from maize. Probably on the order of 80% of their carbohydrates are from maize. So anytime an archaeologist talks about any sequence anywhere in the world, we always feel kind of bad because we feel that maybe it's not quite generalizable. But there are, I believe, many things that are generalizable about the Neolithic sequence that I'm going to be talking about from up here, from AD 600, AD 1300. And one of the things that makes it an attractive area to study is that we know a very great deal about the site distributions. We have very good dating because of tree ring records. So we can watch these processes in a great deal of detail that is not possible in other areas. But despite that, there are a few particularities to this record, and I'll try and point those out to you, so it's not absolutely general. One of the particularities is that, and I don't know how well this shows up back there, but this tan area here represents the area that was occupied, say, in the late 1200s, but the reddish area represents the areas that were still occupied by the late 1300s, early 1400s. So there was a vast settlement retraction beginning in the 1200s and lasting up on into the 1500s, with huge areas of the northern southwest going way beyond the northern portions of this slide, depopulated in the late 1200s. So that's a bit of a mystery, but it's not a total mystery, and we'll be seeing some of the reasons for that, but I'm not going to dwell on that. Before I leave this slide, I want to make sure that you see Mesa Verde National Park. Our little research area that I'm going to be talking about tonight is in fact quite a bit larger by now. It's all this area, and we also have another big area down here, but I'm not going to be talking about these two expansions because we're not that far along with our work in those two new areas. But another actor in this drama is going to be Chaco Canyon right there, which, speaking in Santa Fe, I assume that quite a few of you are familiar with already. So lesson one is substantive, not methodological, but it rests on a methodological insight that is due to a French demographer named Jean-Pierre Bocquet-Appel, who in 2002 published a quite a nice article in Current Anthropology that he called Paleoanthropological Traces of a Neolithic Demographic Transition. And it fell like a bombshell, at least in my opinion, because for a long time, archaeologists, including and other anthropologists, including Marcus Feldman, who I think is around here someplace, wrote about waves of expansion of agriculturalists out of the Near East into Europe and so forth. And of course, that requires a period of very high population growth at the wavefront to make that work. But nobody had really been able to demonstrate in the archaeological record that that was true. So Bocquet-Appel did two things that made it possible to do that. First of all, he built a very simple ratio of the proportion of juveniles in a burial population. That would be individuals aged between 5 and 19 years old, divided by all the individuals 5 years old or older in that burial population, discarding everybody below five because preservation is so chancy on those individuals. And when that proportion is high, the instantaneous rate of population increase is very high as well. This is approximately the location of an R of zero, growth rate of zero. And so we see that in this period here, there are quite high growth rates. This axis is also hard to understand. It's a relative measure of time because he's working in this particular image across a large area that goes all the way from the Near East and North Africa to Europe. Zero is the point at which Neolithic adaptations, including domesticated animals and domesticated plants, arrive in some particular area. So minus 1,000 would be 1,000 years before that in that same area. 1,000 would be 1,000 years after that in the same area. And basically, he was able to show using these little tricks that whenever the Neolithic arrived in an area, it resulted in a long period of very elevated population growth that was followed by a period of some decline in population growth that he attributed to people beginning to live in more aggregated villages, often with domesticated animals that would carry zoonoses, and so it was harder for them to be healthy under those circumstances. There are probably other reasons as well. There's often heightened warfare, for example, in sites of that era. We can and have applied some of these same techniques to the US Southwest. Here's that same line of 0.18, a very low growth rate. We can actually see that growth rates in the red line is the southern Southwest, the green is the northern Southwest, so the area I'm talking about is the green. And we can see that growth rates of 1,000 years ago, 1,000 BC in the Southwest, were still very low. In fact, if we were to take this literally below replacement rate, I doubt that that's true, but there are perhaps some oddities here in the local archaeological record that we have to take into account. The important thing, though, is that when agriculture reaches the northern Southwest, the Mesa Verde area and the areas around that, population growth is extremely high. So if you were to sum these curves, you would see quite a nice bump in population growth for this period right here. And once again, we see this funny decline around AD, late AD 1200s, AD 1300, that also accompanies the depopulation of vast areas of the northern Southwest. One of my first methodological lessons when I arrived at SFI and was exposed to tools like agent-based modeling was that it often pays to disaggregate the problem. Archaeologists had for a long time been interested in problems like the formation of a village, but we would take the village as the entity to be analyzed, or we would take a river valley settlement system as the entity to be analyzed. And it was important to make progress on this problem, to begin to attack it in a more disaggregated fashion, to look at the behaviors of the households and how they move across the landscape and what might entice them into a village or repel them from being in a village. My first visit to SFI was in February 1992. I remember it very clearly. It was, of course, not in the present beautiful building, but it was in the temporary building down by the medical complex at that time. It was to attend one of a small series of workshops on Southwestern prehistory that was undertaken in conjunction with the School of American Research. And I now understand that Murray Gell-Mann and possibly George Cowan were largely responsible for SFI's interests in this area, but I, as a junior participant at that time, I had no awareness of that whatsoever. But it was quite obvious to me that there was a wonderful set of intellects gathered at SFI, and I particularly spent quite a long time talking with Chris Langton about agent-based modeling, and I ended up coming back the next year for a sabbatical and spent a long time working with what came to be called the Swarm Group on agent-based modeling, and a very early version of some of the models I'll be showing you tonight was in fact distributed as a sort of proof of principle for Swarm back in 95 or so. The area that I pointed out to you as the Village Ecodynamics Project area has the following population history. There's three bars here, but we're just going to look at the green bars because they're most important. The others can be regarded as sort of informal confidence intervals. There's a first cycle of population growth peaking right around here, then a rather rapid decline, followed by another rapid buildup right along here, with then a very rapid population decrease, followed by a complete and total depopulation by the farmers. The thin red line you see is a measure of aggregation, and it's a very simple measure. Aggregation is measured as the proportion of households in a particular cell on a rasterized landscape, and these cells happen to be 200 by 200 meters in size, that have eight or more other households with them. So the proportion is very low early on, meaning households are fairly isolated on the landscape. It rises quite rapidly here, and these are some of the first and largest villages that appear in the Southwest in the 800s. And then decreases along with population size, and then increases quite regularly with population size. And then this little anomaly at the end is that even as population size is decreasing, aggregation continues to increase. We eventually produced an ABM, agent-based model, in Swarm. The current version is in Repast, that took as its starting points this population histogram, although we didn't know it quite so well then. We've done some additional work since then to see to what extent we might be able to reproduce that, and also the locations of all the households across the landscape. And we knew something about the climates and the landscapes of southwestern Colorado, and we posed to the ABM the problem, posed to the households in the ABM the problem of trying to find a place on the landscape where they could get enough maize to survive as climates changed, enough wood, enough water, and enough protein from three animals species that they hunted, deer, rabbit, and hare. And this is not maybe a terribly difficult problem, but it's not completely easy either, because the climates are always changing, and that changes the resource distributions. And then moreover, as people use resources, that changes the resource distributions. And as households move around tracking the resources, that also changes the densities of the resource distributions and the opportunities for other households to move in. And clearly, this is a great problem for agent-based modeling, but a very difficult problem for archaeologists to solve without a tool like agent-based modeling. In fact, absolutely impossible. Another thing we asked the household, we allowed the households to do some exchanges with each other. They could do reciprocal exchanges of maize or of meat, and that would to some extent boost the productivity across the landscape as a whole and also stabilized agent locations slightly. So the villages that form in this period, which are called Pueblo I villages, are almost impossible to see on the ground unless you have kind of a trained eye. And I realize you can't see anything there. But there would have, in fact, been probably somewhat more than 100 households at this village, which is called Grass Mesa Pueblo, at its peak. And there would have been a whole row of pit houses along there, and another row of surface rooms right behind them, and another row of pit houses here, and another row of surface rooms there. And you can just barely see a little bit of a ridge there where those things were. And then down here at the bottom, a great kiva, actually two great kivas. And so the later villages looked somewhat different, depending on whether we're here or here. But at this point, this is a village called Sand Canyon Pueblo. They're pretty big, and one of the things that they have that the earlier villages did not have is a wall around them. They also are heavy-duty masonry construction, and if you walk up to these sites today, there's no problem whatsoever with seeing them. Anybody can see them quite easily. So, and yet, at the same time, there were no villages where Grass Mesa was 50 years before that, and there were no villages where this was 50 years before that. So why then and why there? Those were problems that were good for agent-based modeling. So here's a movie of, this is actually a swarm version running, and what we're seeing is little households, and I know it's hard to see in the back, little red dots are 1 to 2 households, yellow dots are 3 to 8 households, and so forth. And the greens we're seeing on the landscape are deer densities. And where deer are very high in density, they're bright green. Where they're low in density, they're very dull green or black. We never allow the deer to quite go away. There's a diffusion algorithm that's running from cell to cell here that makes it so that deer never quite disappear. And one of the things that we learned very rapidly by running these simulations is that resources that are slowly renewable were really problematic for these people, because in the first episode of village formation in this area, households were faced with a problem that they had never been faced with before, and that is that there were many more of them living in one place, and they were very concentrated in space, and they were less mobile on the landscape. When you put all of those things together, that means that they were much more likely to deplete their local resources than they would have otherwise. So this calls for some evolution of restraint. Now we're actually looking at the distribution of fuel wood on the landscape and so forth. I'm not going to go through this whole thing. Fuel wood's another thing that gets depleted on this landscape because it's a slow-growing, slowly renewing resource. There are quite a few different things we learn by doing these simulations. I'm not going to be able to talk to you about all of them, but before I get into one of the ones that I think is most interesting, I just want to give you a brief aside about how nice it is to have bright graduate students. And when we were finishing up this big book that Jerry showed you, a fairly new graduate student in my lab named Kyle Bosinski was thinking about the problem of deer depletion. And in fact, we know on this landscape that after about AD 1060 or so, people began to use a lot of turkey. And so he decided for his thesis that he would code a model in which people, agents, households, would be able to raise domesticated turkey by feeding them corn if it were cheaper for them to do so than it would be for them to acquire the same amount of protein in the landscape by hunting. And obviously, as deer becomes depleted on the landscape, turkey becomes more attractive. But turkey is still more attractive if other sources of protein, like hares and rabbits, which together are called legomorphs, are getting depleted as well. So this is what we would call a human behavioral ecological style model, very economic in its orientation. And we're seeing basically the same space as we saw before, but this time we're accumulating an archaeological record that shows you the proportions of deer, blue, legomorphs, that's rabbits and hares, green, and meg, which is Meleagris gallopavo, which is turkey, red. And so as people begin to accumulate a record, and this is over time, that is more and more dominated by turkey, the points turn redder. Where populations are quite low, we still see quite a bit of importance of deer hunting. And then intermediate between those, we have areas where legomorphs are quite important. So this runs very fast, so we'll take it all the way through. Now, obviously, if you were an archaeologist, the first thing you'd want to do is say, does this have any correspondence at all with reality? And I can tell you that it has a lot more correspondence with reality than the previous movie I showed you, in which there's no turkey domestication. Because, in fact, we have good excavations from sites down in here that are late, date to the 1200s, and they have practically nothing but turkey in them, hardly any deer whatsoever. But what we're going to be doing is, you know, that's very anecdotal. We're going to be examining the distribution through time and across space of these proportions, and then try to tune the model to make it better reproduce those proportions. And then we think we will have learned something about the process of turkey domestication. Just as an aside, I would point out that if you, as a Pueblo farmer, are beginning now to get all your carbohydrates from corn, but also all your protein from corn via turkey, that if anything happens to your corn production, you might be in trouble. And in fact, that is one of the things, of course, that happens later on. Another, in the late 1200s, corn production does begin to decline rather drastically. Another direction we're going to go with this model, which I think is quite interesting, this model is based on optimal foraging theory logic, and it requires really a lot of computation for the agents to do this. It would be perhaps more realistic to think that people are not really able to do so much computation, and so we're starting to look at the sorts of heuristics that Gigerenzer's group has been working on to see if we can get these agents to evolve heuristics for the underlying hunting as well as the switch to turkey that will be computationally much cheaper and easier and at least as accurate in its predictions for the archaeological record as is the underlying optimal foraging theory model that we have right now. So one of the other things we can do with the output from these ABMs is to examine what happens in the process of looking at the goodness of fit between the real archaeological record and the output from the model. Now remember that the real archaeological record, I'm sorry, the model, at least to a first approximation, gives us an estimate of where households should locate themselves if they essentially want to get all those critical resources that I mentioned with the least possible effort. So it's a kind of optimality model. It's a kind of least effort model. Does this correspond to anything we see in the archaeological record? Well, without explaining in great detail how these curves are generated, although I'd be happy to do that in the question and answer session if anybody really wants to, these are two different ways of estimating the goodness of fit between the modeled surface and the real archaeological surface. This isn't entirely straightforward because we're concerned with not only matching the locations of the households in each of those planes, but also the numbers of households in each of those planes. And what we see is quite interesting. First of all, when farmers first move into this area, they are very, very far from what we might call the optimal niche. It seems as though this area is so rich when people first move in that you could essentially plunk down your pit house anywhere and make quite a good living, and we can see that in fact they grew very rapidly, so it wasn't a matter of not being able to make a living on the landscape when they first arrived. Another thing that's interesting to me is that we have a very regular increase through time here that's quite sharp in the first occupation cycle. And then we have this big decrease in conjunction with the population decrease here. And then another increase, not quite so sharp, but still pretty sharp. And then in both periods of depopulation, we have a little bit of an increase in the measures of goodness of fit. Now, one way to think about this that I'm attracted to is to think that, as Robert Foley said, that there are only really pressures for optimization on these populations to the extent that there's competition, and the competition is always going to be highest when the population is the greatest. So it seems plausible that people are being pushed into the better spots on the landscape because of those competitive processes. And it's also quite interesting that as the going got tough, because this is a production downturn here, this is a big production downturn here, that people are forced into the best areas. One way to understand that is that people might have been leaving the slightly more suboptimal areas first, and the last people to leave are those people in some of the best areas. Another thing that's quite interesting about this is that, or maybe another way of understanding this, and actually Crow Canyon, with whom I'm affiliated, is doing quite a lot of excavations in sites of this period right now, and maybe we'll have some answers about this in a bit. But it seems like the farmers who are coming into our area, which is a high elevation area with very deep soils, which is quite different than anything anybody in the Southwest had farmed prior to that time. Most of these people had come from farming in canyonland environments. And so it perhaps a way of understanding this is that it just took them a long time to kind of map onto this landscape, that they were quite slow and quite conservative in their farming practices, so that it took them a while to develop the best locational strategies for using the best soils. Maybe they just didn't understand how to use those soils. Farmers are very conservative. So in any case, the comparison between these two records poses problems that we couldn't possibly have even recognized were it not for the fact that we had the model. And one more thing I'd like to point out about this is that there are many reasons to believe, and you'll see some of them soon, that the socio-political organization in this period here and this period here were quite a bit different. This was much more simple village-level organizations in which households probably retained a great deal of autonomy. And you see that the households are really able to locate themselves quite optimally with respect to access to those resources. Here, there was a much more complex polity with probably two or three different levels of leadership. And I think that households had lost a great deal of their autonomy in their choices about where to live with respect to those resources. Well, so we saw this same graph before, but I'd like to just point out that there's a bit of another anomaly here, or another puzzle, and that's why the history of aggregation and the measures of optimality that we saw track each other quite closely in the first occupation cycle, but they only track each other loosely in the second cycle. So that's a problem we'll return to, but it's another line of evidence that we wouldn't have been able to see otherwise. Okay, well, enough of complicated models for a while. I'm a great believer in models, but I'm also a great believer in the idea that a model can be extremely simple and still be very useful. About 8 years ago, I spent several months here on sabbatical, and sitting next to me in the office next door was a computational immunologist named Stanka Chupe. And I had recently read an article by Peter Turchin laying out a model for the relationship between population size and warfare. And we started talking about it. And this model is as simple as a model as you could get. It's two coupled ordinary differential equations, one for population size, n along this axis. This is time along here. Just the proportion. The black line shows us a measure of population size. The gray line shows us a measure of warfare. And those of you who know predator-prey models, for example, will see that there's a lot of similarity between this and a simple predator-prey model. As population goes up, then eventually with a lag, warfare goes up, then that brings population down, et cetera, et cetera. And it keeps cycling like that. If we were to look at it in phase space, it'd look like this. Get rid of that other one. And so you would eventually expect, this is population size here, this is incidence of warfare here, you would eventually expect them to reach a point equilibrium. Of course, that would never happen in a real cultural system because there's all sorts of noise all the time happening and changes in climate and so forth. But that's the expectation of the model. At base, this is a model for warfare as resource stress in a population that has limited means to expand its production as population increases. It's also important to remember that Turchin thought that this would only apply to internal warfare, that is within a society, not to competition between polities. That will be important in what comes. Fortunately, I had another bright graduate student sitting up in Pullman named Sarah Cole, and she was able to look at all hundreds and hundreds of archaeological reports that had accumulated on this area and look at reports on the human remains from those and was able to quantify the incidence of violence on those remains. And she was careful to try and avoid things like a broken rib that you could get because you fall out of your cliff dwelling or something like that. A lot of these were cranial fractures of some sort or another or perifractures, things like that. And this black line is the smooth population curve from our area. And the gray line is the smooth incidence of warfare. Both of these are represented as z-scores here. And so it starts off fairly low, but not zero, then goes very low, And then this is warfare, has a little peak right there and then comes back down and then rises very rapidly. Now, if we were looking at the raw proportions instead of a z-score, that peak there is about 90%, 0.9. So that means that 90% of the human remains in this period died violent deaths, or at least experienced violence around the time of their death. That's a huge number. But does it fit the Turchin model? Well, here's what the Turchin model, here's what it looks like in phase space. Remember, the Turchin model had a cycle going counterclockwise like that. What happens here is very nice, quite early, we have a very constrained sort of relationship between population and violence from about from the 600s all the way through the late 900s. And then something funny happens about 1000 and 1040. We begin to move out of that relationship. And then really all hell breaks loose around 1080. We go in exploring an entirely different portion of the phase space where we have a lot of violence and population is growing fast. And then a little bit of violence decrease. And then this is the terrible time right there with lots of violence. And then things cool off quite a bit. And we have very relatively low levels of violence, even though we have very high population. Well, Stanka more or less threw up her hands at this because to try and fit one model to essentially three regimes is completely impossible. She did her best, but she showed, in fact, that there were three very distinct regimes here. And that made us try to figure out what was going on. Of course, we weren't totally naive. Those of you who have visited Chaco Canyon will recognize this as Pueblo Bonito. Pueblo Bonito and several other great houses in Chaco Canyon, quite near to Pueblo Bonito, all began to grow up in the mid to late 800s, then florist in the 900s, and especially in the 1000s. And what we think, or at least I think, and most of my colleagues think, is going on in our record is that Chaco had created a polity that was expanding, and not expanding in a completely benign way. I think that it really wanted to get its hands on the production that was very high and very dependable, relatively speaking, in the Central Mesa Verde area. And that what we have here in the increase of warfare in advance of the increase of population is an attempt to resist the Chacoan incursion. That attempt was ultimately unsuccessful, and we have a Chacoanized landscape in our area by about AD 1080. And another piece of evidence that we have, here's what this looks like in phase space again, just the same thing you saw before, is that from about 1080 through about here, or maybe even a slight bit later, we have in our area, in the northern southwest, we have a deficit of women. And if you look in the Chaco Basin and the Chaco sites further south, they have a surplus of women. And it's really quite plausible that women were being extracted by force, in other words, raiding for women was going on in our area. And another little piece of evidence for that is that in some of the Chacoanized populations along the La Plata River near Farmington, which became a big center for Chacoan society, there's a sort of subclass of women who are buried in very unusual positions and are quite heavily battered. And so if you put all that together, it looks to me and to many other people as though Chaco was a forcefully expanding polity in the 1000s. Its expansion was resisted unsuccessfully. Chaco ultimately collapsed in the mid-1100s. When Chaco collapsed in our area, there was a huge peak of violence. Possibly a great deal of that was score settling as the Chacoan polity fell apart. And then things returned to a rather different social organization. And I infer from the very high populations but the low violence that there was some sort of internal confederacy in our area among these sites that was able to damp the violence. Okay, that's a long story. Here's one more long story, and then we'll be close to done. Does any of this help us understand aggregation? Well, what these little green dots here are, first of all, imagine the raster now of the settlements, a whole bunch of cells, some with many with zero counts in them, some with one, a few with lots of cells, and so forth. And if you compute the mean and the standard deviation across each of those rasters, and we've got 512 from the model and one from the real world, we can compute a coefficient of variation. And here are the coefficients of variation for the simulations in each period, and here are the big red dots for the real settlements in each period. So when the big red dots are above the greens, that means that the CVs are much higher, and the population is more concentrated and more organized on the landscape in these periods right here. This is rather a surprise. We didn't think that the real households would ever be more dispersed on the landscape than our agents were. This seems to me to imply that even though the Pueblo peoples are famous for their communal ways, that in fact this developed over the course of the occupation over these 700 years, and was not at all necessarily an original habit of these agriculturalists. It seems as though when they got on this landscape, they got as far apart from each other as they possibly could. They were in the maximally dispersed condition. In fact, Marshall Solins said something like, maximal dispersal is the state of nature. Anyway, what can we do with this? One thing we can do is to say that we now have a measure of expected aggregation, and the expectation is based on what the agents do, and the agents aggregate. The extent to which the agents aggregate takes into account the resource distributions on the landscape and also the densities of the agents in the vicinity. And so it's holding those things constant in a way. So we can look at a measure that we'll call unexpected aggregation as the distance between the red dot here and the central tendency of the green distribution. So here we have a negative unexpected aggregation. Here we have a very high positive expected aggregation. And we can take a look and see how that responds to some other things that we know about. For example, the density of households on the landscape all in all, and also the warfare index. And we can see, don't pay attention to these units, I should have standardized this, but I didn't. But in general, unexpected aggregation, the distance from here to here, gets bigger as there are more households on the landscape and as there is more warfare on the landscape. This is not entirely a surprise. People have long considered that villages form and endure because of warfare, but if you can remember our record of warfare that I had on the screen just a little bit ago, in fact, we had no warfare when the villages down here were forming. Warfare did increase as these villages were falling apart, but we also know that this period in here was a period of hyper-warfare, and that warfare was increasing as the populations were leaving Mesa Verde in the late 1200s. So, all in all, this is very helpful, but it's not doesn't entirely solve the problem, because we can see, in fact, that there's still about 60% of the variability in that unexplained aggregation that's unaccounted for by this model. You can also see that this model, in fact, is pretty weak, but it's the best we can do. It's the best. Archaeology is notoriously messy. But to me, it raises a really fundamental question, and that has to do with the remainder of the variability here. And there's two ways to think about these big points up here where the unexpected aggregation is so high. If you were thinking about this perhaps as a physicist, you would say that those households are poised in a very improbable state on this landscape. And the probable state would be, down here, something like that, where households have maximal access to the resources they need. So how do you explain that? One way, of course, is to say that they are pushed into that state because of competitive relationships, apparently warfare. But that doesn't seem to explain all of it. Seems to explain only a relatively small part of it. Another way to think about it is that they are pulled up there by some attraction, something that is happening in these aggregates that brings perhaps increasing returns to the occupants in these aggregates that makes it worthwhile for them to live in these improbable conditions, even though they suffer some increased cost in resource access because of that. So now I've started to think about something that's long been popular to think about at Santa Fe Institute, that is returns to scale. And these are, of course, studies that have been done here for quite some time by people like Jeff West and Luis Betancourt. Are households attracted into villages because villages are creating some kind of social or economic value above and beyond the protection they offer in perilous times? Well, now I'm borrowing a slide from a colleague and friend, Scott Ortman. This is from a talk he gave at the Society for American Archaeology meetings just a couple weeks ago. And this is cheating a bit because this slide reports sites down here in the northern Rio Grande area and not in southwestern Colorado. But we're going to close our eyes and hope that we have rather similar things in southwestern Colorado where we haven't done an equivalent study. The blue dots belong to the coalition period, which dates from the 1200s and the very early 1300s. So they're largely contemporaneous with the sites I'm talking about up there. The red dots are quite a bit later, the classic period, which is late 1300s, all the 1400s and the early 1500s. I don't know if you can see the scaling coefficients here for the coalition. We have very, very marginally superlinear scaling. I think it's 1.02. For the classic period sites, it's quite impressively superlinear. It's 1.145. And what we're looking at specifically is the relationship, is how plaza area size. These are the public spaces in which you have ceremonies and in which, importantly, in the classic period, you probably had lots of proto-market exchange. So those are growing more rapidly than the site size is itself, providing some weak evidence, perhaps, for increasing returns to scale for something about these villages. In fact, this might really help us to understand what's going on in the relationship between southwestern Colorado and the northern Rio Grande. You'll remember that in the 1200s, virtually everybody from southwestern Colorado came down to the northern Rio Grande. And if, in fact, the northern Rio Grande populations were finding ways to make their villages have increasing returns to scale in a way that had not been discovered in southwestern Colorado, that might have, in fact, been important in increasing the standard of living down here relative to up there. That's sheer speculation. We need to do this same study for southwestern Colorado, and we will. But one way to begin to understand more about these scale relationships is to recast our model as a public goods game. Now, you probably, virtually all of you probably know how a public goods game works, and that is that if you have a group of people and most of the people in your group contribute to some public good, then that will mean that everybody gets an advantage from that. And nobody is denied access to a public good. A public good is like a wall around a site. That is, you may or may not have helped build it, but you will benefit from it, even if you didn't help build it. So I know that this is extremely hard to see here. Are those little dots moving at all? Okay, good. I'll move it a little bit. That'll help you. Maybe I will. Okay, well, never mind. We'll let it plunk away. I'll show you some of the results in graphic form in a bit. This is, what we did here is to put a mod, agentize and spatialize a model that was published in Journal of Theoretical Biology by a group of people that included Paul Hooper, who's going to be a postdoc here in the fall. And their work was a way of showing the relationship between social group size and the kind of leadership that you would expect to have in a group. And basically, they divided the world into two different kinds of people, people who were willing to live in hierarchical groups and people who weren't. We agentized this. We in the end, made 11 different kinds of agents, and we threw them into a melee competition with each other. And some of the agents were always willing to cooperate but didn't want to live in a hierarchical group. And they did very well as long as populations were very low because everybody in their group would cooperate. But as populations began to increase a little bit, those groups would get invaded by people who would, by households who would not cooperate. And then those groups would do poorly, but then those groups could get invaded by an agent type called a mutual monitor, and those people would punish people who weren't contributing to the public good. But the problem for mutual monitors is that as the population in the groups grew, it was increasingly difficult for the monitors to monitor everybody because it was costly to do so and it was costly to punish, and they didn't get any direct payback for it. They just got the indirect payback that everybody in the group got because of the public goods game. So, on the other hand, in the groups that were hierarchical, the hierarchical groups didn't do any better than anybody else early on. All the hierarchical groups are called H's here, and we allow them. We have different runs of the simulation in which they're formed at 30, 40, and 50 cells radius. In the hierarchical groups, they start out doing not very well because you have a leader, and the leader has to collect taxes, and the leader makes it so that everybody contributes and punishes people who don't contribute, and then after he punishes them, they contribute. So the groups that are hierarchical do well as the group size grows, but they don't necessarily do very well when the group sizes are very small because you're paying the overhead of having a leader. As group sizes grow, the non-hierarchical groups cease to grow at a certain point because it's too hard to monitor, the cost of monitoring is high, and so you don't have good participation in the public goods game. On the other hand, the groups that are hierarchical have very good participation in the public goods game. They edge out the non-hierarchical groups and begin to take over the entire landscape. Another thing that's kind of interesting that emerges, we kept track of the tax rates. And one advantage of having larger groups is that larger groups can have a lower tax rate and still get the job of playing the public goods game done correctly. Okay, we're going to do a lot of development with this model. This model is probably going to be the main one we move forward with on into the future, because basically everything we now want to understand about the archaeology of this area revolves around groups in some way. So we're going to allow these groups to become territorial, which they're not right now. We're going to allow them to develop several tiers of leadership, which they don't right now. They'll be able to take over other groups and form alliances and so forth. And we will see what happens. We'll see if it has any relationship at all to the archaeological record. One nice thing about this work is that we always have the archaeological record to come back to. So, this is another lesson I learned when I was putting this together. I should never have promised 10. My last lesson is don't be afraid to take a crude look at the whole. And I'm going to return us now to something we mentioned early on, and that is temperatures. Until very recently, most temperature reconstructions for the last 2,000 years had an extremely flat temperature distribution up until about 100 years ago, and you remember the famous hockey stick diagram by Michael Mann, in which temperatures just shoot up in the last 100 years, and that's quite in contrast to the earlier flat period. Well, more recently, more variable temperature records have been generated. including this one down here by Anders Moberg, which we're tracking along here. And we've just developed a very simple kind of simulation that puts the Moberg reconstruction on the ground, keeping in mind that maize needs about 2,000 growing degree days to be able to survive. And as this line moves around, different places come in and out of that 2,000 growing degree days. It's staying pretty far north here, but we produced this thing about 3 weeks ago, and just last week we got another temperature reconstruction, a newer, better temperature reconstruction. It turns out to be even more variable, and now we're getting through the last of the medieval warm period. We're starting to fall down into the Little Ice Age here, which is going to be quite a bit colder in the Little Ice Age than here, and we're going to have this 2,000 degree day line fall quite a bit further south. So we are now thinking that it's quite plausible that the depopulation of the northern southwest is caused by the sliding of the entire northern hemisphere into the Little Ice Age. And we're now beginning to wonder, in fact, if some of the big Mississippian sites out in this area in the northern Midwest might also have met their ends, as they do in the 1200s, because of decreases in the distribution of growing degree days very locally. So this is an example of heavy-duty computation. Each of these maps, even though it's a very simple model for making this computation, this map has 250,000 pixels in it, and every one of those has to have a regression solved for every year of this. And so it's something that archaeologists probably wouldn't have undertaken a few years ago, but we can now. Okay. I have already probably exceeded my time a little bit, but one can't be at SFI and not think about what other things one could be doing and SFI could be doing. And these are pretty myopic, because these are basically from the perspective of an archaeologist. But I'm very excited about the Templeton Project, which I have a small role in. And I think that comparing the trajectories of societies as they become larger in demographic scale and more hierarchical is completely appropriate thing for SFI to do. And in fact, I'd like to see us go a step further with that and challenge the cultural history records with specific computational models and see how they behave on those computational models and compare the societies by looking at the residuals from those models in those various societies. I would also like us to try to learn more about climate as a complex system and develop close working relationships with some climate scientists who can help us deal with its complexity. I can imagine funny little things like taking a version of the village simulation and trying to crowdsource various modules for it, say for things that are kind of difficult to figure out how they would work, like social hunting or for warfare, and enable them to have be developed in a competition, so and that SFI researchers would determine which of those were best by dint of the fit that they provide to the archaeological record along several clearly specified dimensions. Of course, we'd have to have prize money and things like that, so obviously this would have to be a grant. And many other things that I can think of, but I want to close by just acknowledging, first of all, NSF, but perhaps more important in this venue, SFI, for 2 decades of support and inspiration. Thank you very much. Yeah, are there questions?
Yeah, sure. It's
On one level, I think it's a very simple story, but on another level, it's complicated. But the simple part of the story is that as temperatures cooled in the 1200s, some agriculturalists in the distant north, the Fremont farmers in Utah, were probably pushed south. As they were pushed south, that provided increasingly competitive conditions for people who were not yet suffering. And you may remember the big spike in population in the Central Mesa Verde region from 1225 to 1260 on those graphs that I showed many, many times. Those people are coming in just as climate conditions are deteriorating. They're certainly not attracted to our area. They're pushed into it because other areas are less attractive. Shortly after that, the area just blows up and there's massive violence. And the only three villages from that period that have been excavated in modern times using contemporary techniques all were completely, everybody in that village was killed. So they were all massacred. And so exactly who these people were conducting the massacre, I'm not sure, but it probably involved these populations that were coming down in. They probably saw those relatively privileged populations still there. They wiped them out and the whole system fell apart and people came down here. That's my reading of it.
So your chart that, or your plot there at the end that showed these three temperature bars or degree day bars,
yes,
fluctuating like heck in the left half of the country and stable as can be in the right half of the country.
Yes.
Is that bad data, no data, or why didn't anybody go there to live?
Well, first of all, I would say that movie that I showed you was very much a pilot study, not something that I would want to publish or not something that I would want anybody else to base a publication on. We are now starting to work with Bo Christensen and Frederik Lundqvist, Danish climate scientists, and they have made some suggestions for how we should go about doing this that will improve the goodness of fit in the eastern United States and will also probably increase the goodness of fit, in fact, in the West as well. But they're particularly interested in that problem. And the reconstruction that we're using right now from Moberg is a northern hemisphere-wide reconstruction. So it contains lots of climate data that is perhaps not completely relevant. And we're going to be working with Christiansen and Lundqvist to try to develop a reconstruction that is specific to North America, that uses only proxies that are specific to North America, and also proxies that are primarily sensitive to summer temperature, not necessarily annual temperature, as many of those proxies were. So there are going to be many refinements. And so I'm troubled by what you saw as well, but I don't necessarily think it's real at this point.
Yeah, Tim?
Yeah, I'm just asking an obvious question, robustness of your models. So how robust, you must have looked into the reproducibility if you change
yes,
the initial conditions or
yes,
assumptions,
yeah,
and how certain your data.
Yeah, a good question. Every single one of the models that I showed you began from the same random number seed in those simulations, but we have also obviously investigated the effect of different random number seeds. And because there is a lot of stochasticity in the model, essentially what happens when we use different random number seeds is that the simulations can be quite different at the beginning, but then as they run, they get more and more similar to each other. So it's sort of the opposite of path dependence. Okay, yes. Yes. Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. Yeah. Sure. Yeah. Right. Well, as modelers in this room will recognize, there's a huge number of parameters in a model like this. The model, the things that we're most interested in knowing about that we think we know the least about, we parameterize in the sense that we, for example, will run the model with low protein requirements for the household and high protein requirements for the households because we really don't know what the protein requirements for the households were. And likewise, for the productivity of the landscape, we have a parameter that we can tune, and so we can go from relatively low to relatively high. We could search as many as we want, but it's computationally intensive to do so. And one of the big problems with models like this is that we have many more the parameter space is much larger than the space over which we can intensively search. And so we have a very light sampling of the potential parameter space. And all I can say, Walter, in response to that is that we will continue to try to refine these parameters. Some of the things that we, in some ways, this activity turns around then to the empirical record. And people may never have cared before about how much time people are spending hoeing their fields or cutting down trees or something like that. But all that is taken into account in our model, so that if we can ask those questions and find out answers for those things, we'll be better off. In most cases, for things like that, we've taken the data from published ethnographic studies that are more or less relevant. But we would always like to be able to refine those estimates.
Tim, I was really interested in what you were talking about with the cooperation and the low level of villages, small villages, and changing over time. Have you found a tipping point where cooperation doesn't work anymore without a hierarchy, or is that something you'll be looking for?
One thing you might be asking is, why is it that the Pueblo One villages fall apart? Because they had apparently a very simple structure of leadership, and they were what anthropologists would often call village-level societies. So one tier of leadership probably within the villages. My reconstruction of what happened there is that they had a problem that was partly a resource problem and partly a cooperation problem. So if you imagine that you have, for the first time, many more people living together at a specific point in the landscape for a much longer period of time than it had ever been the case, they're going to be using a lot of the resources up within their vicinity, like the deer, like the forest resources. The interesting thing about the later villages is that they have seemed to have solved these resource use problems somehow. For example, the later villages don't seem to be, in the real archaeological record, using up all the wood around their villages. Somehow, they've evolved what you might call some constraints in resource use that had not yet been worked out in the earliest villages. So whether or not one wants to regard that as a resource problem or a coordination problem, a cooperation problem, depends on whether you think that the evolution of resource constraint is a subset of the problem of the evolution of cooperation, which I happen to think is the case. So there was a failure in my reconstruction of cooperation because there was a failure in the evolution of resource constraint. But these were all new problems. Many, many early Neolithic villages fell apart under very similar circumstances. And it was only later on that substantial villages could stay in one place for a very long period of time because somehow they had solved those problems.
Thank you, everyone. No.